press the bell icon on the YouTube app to never miss a video from News Laundry.
So welcome, Barkha. You have been told, Barkha needs no introduction. Just to give you a perspective, I was also told I need no introduction because I think Bablu felt bad that after Barkha needs an introduction, and then the other guys so-and-so. But I have worked in various capacities in news in the last 15, 20 years, and I have also worked at NDTV for a while, writing a satire show, and Barkha was the queen of the party. But we'll come to that later. Barkha, fantastic reporting on the ground on COVID.
Thank you.
And like we were told, you were the first one out there. Before we get into the journey of Mojo and your other enterprise that you're running, tell me, when did you decide? Because you, I think within the lockdown, within the first week you were out. So was it like a spontaneous decision, chalo 22 kilometer jaake aa jaate hain, and then you just carried on, or you had said, okay, I'm going to head out and I'm only going to come back after like 100 days on the road?
No, here's how it happened. The Prime Minister announces at 8 p.m. that from midnight the country is going to close. And I wake up the next morning and initially I say, let me just go to the borders of Delhi to see what's happening. And I go to the border and I find, one, that I'm the only journalist there, which kind of shocks me. The second, that there's no police there, which shocks me even more. There's no representation of the state, of no state, not the center, not Delhi, not the border states of UP. And I just see people walking. So initially, I just took a couple of photographs. I thought maybe it's an aberration.
Even by yourself?
I went with, by then I had a small team of a producer and a camera person. So the three of us just got into the car and we said, border tak dekh ke aate hain kya ho raha hai. So we went to the border. And we saw these men, and initially it was only men, and they were very angry. And they were walking, and I took a couple of photographs. And then I said, let me check another state border. Let me just go. I was at the UP border. I said, let me see what's happening at the Punjab border. And I found that the same thing was happening. And I remember that the first day what I did was, I just tweeted the chief minister saying something very dangerous is happening, because I could pick up that the exodus of people from the cities had begun. But I did not know the scale that I was about to witness. So the first couple of days, I would go to the border and I would come back, because I wasn't sure quite what to do. And then I realized, because for 3 days in a row, I saw this happening. And there was no response, nothing. I must have marked my video reports, my photographs to every single chief minister, every single central minister. There was nothing, there was just silence. And that week ended with that first panic reaction that, chalo, let them all go home by bus. So you saw a whole horde of them gathering at the Anand Vihar bus stop. And suddenly, all of our elite started saying, ye gareeb log, ye dekho, inko social distancing karna nahi aata, etc. Because nobody had even thought of placing people in single file. Like, it is so elementary. You could have had paramilitary, you could have had police, you could have said, 200 people at a time, make a single file line, here are the barriers, put 10 barriers on the road. None of that happened. And that end of that first week is when I realized I can't sit inside my office, inside my house and tell this story. I didn't know the scale of what I was going to witness once I set forth, but I gave myself a week in the capital observing this, observing the invisibility of the story in terms of the media, observing the non-response of the government, and pretty much realizing that this story is not even going to be understood unless you're out there.
And that's when you stepped out, and what was the first place you headed to? Across UP, Punjab?
No.
So you had decided when you said, okay, now I'm going to get out there, but just get out and come back, or you knew that you'd go right across India?
I had no idea that I would be going right across India. And in the first couple of weeks, I would sometimes drive 16, 18 hours. I spent some nights in the car. Sometimes I would say, it doesn't matter if we don't sleep, let's just get back to base in Delhi. The reason for that was that these were the early days. We hadn't yet done a calculation of how much risk we were willing to take. And there was nothing open. There was literally nothing open. There was nowhere to stay. There was nowhere to eat.
So where did you stay? Where did you eat?
So the first few days we came back to Delhi, even if it meant we spent some nights in the car, we spent some, in some cases, friends of friends. Do you know anyone in Udaipur? Haan, mera ek dost hai, uska ek dost hai, uska ek dost hai, uske paas ek khet hai, khet mein ek kamra hai, omelette mil jayega. There were a lot of those moments. But in the, again, so it was in stages. The first week I did all of the borders of Delhi and I said, oh my God, I need to leave. The next week I would like drive to Jaipur, come back to Delhi same day. I drove to Indore and back in one go. Wow. Because there was nowhere to stay. But we did have a local stringer whom we hired and I said, can I sleep in your house for 2 hours? Because it was the first time I wore a PPE and I wasn't prepared for, and we can talk about that, I wasn't prepared for how that was going to make me feel. And I felt so sick at the end of it, I actually had to ask him, can I just rest for a few hours in your house? So he said, sure. So he gave us a bed and we slept, he gave us dal chawal. And then we said, let's go back. So initially that's how we approached it. And then we were like, this is just idiotic. Let's just leave. And once we left, we didn't know that we would be able to get to Bombay. Our aim was very modest. Can we do Delhi to Bombay via Rajasthan, Gujarat? And we also, at that time, there was a reason that Gujarat and Maharashtra were the worst states at the time that we left. And we didn't think we could get to Bombay. And once we got to Bombay, we were like, now we're in Bombay. Oh, Hyderabad is, what, 13 hours away. Karnataka is another 13 hours. Can we do Kerala? It's 2 days. By then we got used to 2 days, felt like nothing. 48 hours felt like nothing. And that's how it happened.
And you also got places to stay and eat.
And it got, well, just because, you know, been around so long, you kind of know, you can sometimes cajole people, you can sometimes argue your way, and you can sometimes plead. So I then developed this trick. I had one of three kind of tricks in this. I would either just post online, and I would say, does anyone have a place to stay in so-and-so place? And there were people who would respond. Or I would call the district collector of an area and I would say, I'm here. I have nowhere to stay. I don't need anything from you except for you to give permission for me for a guest house to give me a room. There were no hotels, for a guest house to give me a room. And they'd say temperature check hoga, you know, all that, oximeter check hoga. So that would get checked and then, so we developed ways, but often it was still friends of friends of friends.
Okay, now along the way, tell us about some of the stories you came across, the ones that shocked you or didn't shock you, that surprised you, inspired you, very depressing ones as well.
So I'm going to go through some of these photographs, and Angad, if you could just, you know, so what I found, my life became this kind of surreal sort of moment where, so just to give you a sense, we covered by the end of it about 24,000 kilometers. And we traveled by the end of it from the north to the south. So the southernmost state I was able to reach was Kerala. And somewhere in the middle, the whole standoff with China happened. And so if you just hold on to that picture for a second. And then I reached Ladakh. But if we, so that's a picture you see, that's literally nighttime and it was raining. And what had started happening was that men, women and children were either walking on highways or they were begging trucks, commercial trucks that were plying for lifts. And the truck drivers were very, very scared because they thought that the police would haul them up. But as we traveled and the days went by, as happens in India, a kind of jugaad system emerged for people to travel. So, I mean, these are photographs in no particular order, but this is how a lot of people traveled. They traveled at the back of trucks. There were sometimes 100, 150 people in the backs of trucks. That's actually in the outskirts of Hyderabad. And these workers who had no money, who were out of jobs, their factory workers were not paying them, they would pay 3,000 to 10,000 rupees to get a spot on the truck. And they would huddle together like this, women and children. And this particular photograph, I remember the little girl's name was Pallavi. And I said, you know, you've had to leave where you lived. You know, what is your dream? And she said, well, I'm going to grow up and I'm never going to be poor. My dream is I'm never going to be poor. And I just remember how much that stayed with me, and which is why, like, I met hundreds of people, but I can never forget this little girl. And then here were other children. And, you know, I called them the children of the lockdown because nobody had spoken about what was happening to children, children who are going through this acute psychological, physical, economic displacement. And that's also in Andhra Pradesh. And this became, Abhinandan, in some ways, a defining image of my life. Like, I would go to a state and I would meet a man or a woman carrying a child on their head, or just their entire universe packed into some little sack on their head. And this man was going to walk 700 kilometers on foot to his village, and had like their money was enough to get them biscuits and water. And it would just enrage me, because at the same time, you had the Supreme Court being told by the highest law officer of this land that there are no migrants on the road. And every day I would meet these poor people on the road and I would say to them, you know, what's making you leave? And they would just say one thing, the poverty is going to kill us before the virus. We have no way to stay, you know, where we are. And so, you know, these are the kind of, like, I have hundreds of such images sort of recorded. This was another man carrying a five-year-old child. And the women would often carry the bags and the men would carry the children. And if, you know, one day I asked them, some people found it very intrusive of me, but I did think that, what do you carry when you leave? Like, what happens? Like, if you had to pack one bag, and I'm just leaving that thought with all of you also, like, if you had one bag to carry and move your life, what would you carry in it? And I found it so moving because workers I met, they were carrying three white plastic buckets. And I said, can I, if you don't mind, can I see what's in this bucket? Haan, dekhiye, they were going to Bihar from Andhra Pradesh. And in that were their ozar, their workmen's tools, their shovels, their hammers, just their tools. And one blanket. And I said, why are you carrying this? Kahin kaam mil jayega. So that sense of wanting to earn a living never left. That's just, you know, we'll talk about it later. I did the rounds of many COVID hospitals and we had to do this full gear. This story, Abhinandan, to answer your question, this one just, it stayed with me. It was among the earliest stories I did. It was from Haryana. It was from a village where a migrant worker from Bihar, his name was Mukesh, he sold his mobile phone. This happened a lot, but this was the first such story I found where a man sold his mobile phone. His mobile phone got him 2,000 rupees. With 500 rupees, he bought a fan because it was really hot. He gave the rest of the money to his wife because there was no access to rations. And the next morning, he basically tied himself to a bamboo pole in his neighborhood and killed himself. And this was his family. And the administration was irate with me after this story because in India, to say that there's a hunger-driven suicide is a very political kind of thing. And they said, no, he had mental health issues. So I investigated the story a little more. I went back to the father, and the father said, the father-in-law rather was illiterate, and he said the police came and they made me put my angutha on a statement, and they said, you put your angutha, nahi to aapke khilaf police case ho jayega. So these are really, I mean, you know, we'll place the photographs in loop, and if I see something more that's interesting, I'll talk about it. But that these are the kind of things that, and they would haunt me. You know, they would haunt me. And sorry, just this boy's name was, he was 9 years old, and his name was Nitin. And I said to him playfully, as he was getting into a bus from Bhiwandi, which is in Maharashtra, to go to Azamgarh in UP, and I said to him, aapko malum hai coronavirus kya hai? Do you know what the coronavirus is? Haan. I said, batao. He said, uska matlab hai, mujhe khana nahi milta. That was his definition. And so basically, I witnessed that we had two challenges. We had the pandemic, and then we had this humanitarian crisis unfolding, and it was unfolding in a way that was almost invisible for the longest time, at least in our television channels. And we just couldn't get enough people to care till we just did it relentlessly. And finally we broke through and, you know, finally things moved. But in the beginning it was like, I guess people were so worried for their own lives that they just didn't want to hear about tragedy. The other thing that happened to me was, as I traveled with these people, I went from being a supporter of the lockdown to an absolute opponent of the lockdown. The lockdown was literally achieving nothing. Like, I think after the first 3 weeks, it should have been called off in phases. Because I saw slum tenements where 8 people lived in one room. And I was like, what does stay at home mean for these people? I did research and I found that 92 million households in India live in one room homes. I was like, what does stay at home mean for these people? I went to COVID hospitals where the wards were the size of our closets. And I was like, what? You can't even socially distance inside a hospital. So we have taken a cut and paste, copy and paste model from the West, well-intentioned. Like everybody else, I was like, this needs to be done. It needs to give our health system space. But as it went on, the humanitarian crisis was so gigantic that it was like, and it was not, and as the data now shows us from the serological surveys, that the infection is hugely widespread and actually not as lethal. I think the lockdown should have been recalibrated a lot earlier.
Okay, we'll come back to the story, that's fine, because we want to hear this story as well. I mean, I was just thinking, my journey around the country has been so different from yours. I used to produce and direct a show called Highway on My Plate, so we drove all over the country, and we drove all over the country looking at food, and you drove all over looking at hunger. But now tell me about the experience of, and here I'm asking as a news professional who also runs an organization, how much risk is acceptable risk as a news professional? And What is the kind of risk that you found acceptable? And, you know, tell us about the PPE kit. When did you say, okay, I'll put this on and enter the hospital?
Yeah. So the confusing thing in reporting this story has been that the science has changed so often. So when I started reporting it, I remember I was interviewing the chief scientist at the World Health Organization, who happens to be Indian. And I said to her, should I be wearing masks? And she said, absolutely not. I'm sitting here in Geneva. I'm not wearing a mask. Why are you wearing a mask? Leave the mask for the doctors. So we wouldn't wear masks because that's what we were told. I went to All India Medical Institute. I asked the resident doctors the same question. They said, masks, don't touch the masks. We need them. That seemed reasonable. Why should we be, you know, going? Sure. And even the PPE was a morally difficult question for me because at that time there was this sense that there weren't going to be enough PPEs. But I was like, if I have to enter a COVID hospital, then I have to wear a PPE. In any case, the hospitals don't let you enter. It's right. Totally their determination where you can go, what you should wear. Now, this question of acceptable risk is a very difficult one because left to myself, I am a maverick. And it's not that I'm not scared, but my adrenaline would push me to take extreme risk. That has been the trajectory of my career when I've really wanted to do something. But as someone who now runs a small organization, I can't apply that personality to my colleagues, right? So it was a very difficult decision for me to take. In terms of travel, we were a four-person team, a driver, a camera person, and a field producer, and me. And so small, lean, and the camera person among us was really petrified. The producer was not, the driver was not, I was not. But he really had a problem with what we were doing. And so there were times when he chose to stay out and we went and filmed ourselves. You know, so we had to let him have that choice. Which I think in a previous avatar of mine, you know, if I were an employee in NDTV, I was like, what the hell, why can't you go? But being responsible now for another life suddenly felt much more complicated. I felt more frightened by that than I felt at the risks I had to take for myself. So there is no way to define what's acceptable risk. Here's how I saw it. I saw the media was listed as an exempt essential service. There were other people taking the same risks that I was ready to take, which is that they were going out to do their job. They were going into hospitals. They were going into bastis. They were doing tests. There were shopkeepers taking the same risk. The ration store owner was taking a risk. The security guard at hospital, at All India Medical
Institute. Zomato boys, Swiggy boys.
The Zomato boys, the Swiggy boys, the nurses, the sanitation workers, the people sweeping our streets. So who was I to say I can't take the same risk as, you know, as all of these people? And I felt that this was now a test of why I became a journalist. And I felt like if I don't do this, I have flunked. And it reminded me of this, a 19-year-old soldier I met in Kargil. And I had asked him, whatever, 21 years ago, don't you feel scared? And he said, of course I feel scared. But if I don't do this, my entire life, I prepared for this moment to join the military. If I can't do this, this is what I was trained for. And if I can't do this, it was a meaningless choice. And if I had to fast forward to this moment, I felt there were nights I would wake up and I'd say, I'm going to get this thing. It's in the beginning, I used to feel it a lot. But if I can't do this, why did I become a journalist? And it becomes that kind of obsessive internal thing. So all we told ourselves, and we got a bit careless as we went along because, and we can talk about that, but all we told ourselves is we'll hand sanitize. We'll wash our hands. So we carried bottles of water in our dicky and we'll wear normal masks. We didn't wear N95. By the end of it, we just wore those three-tier surgical masks and that's all we can do. And we did it. And if we go inside a COVID ward, we will have to wear a PPE. These are the four things we did.
And you wanted to tell us about the PPE kit experience. What was that like?
So I bring this up only because, so initially what I would discover that every time I would wear a PPE, that evening I would be sick. And I used to feel very embarrassed. Because,
sick as in?
I would have to often run out of the place I was reporting, strip to the skin, somehow get out of it, pour a bottle of water on myself because my body felt like the body temperature was kind of altering because I was like sweating and I was feeling asphyxiated. And then that feeling would stay with me for many hours. And I would feel so embarrassed because I think of myself as this really tough reporter, and I would hate that people would get to see this. And people saw it. People would see me pouring bottles of water on myself and, you know, generally looking completely mad and needing to sleep it off if I could after I'd filed the story and all of that. And then I started talking to nurses who have to, and by the way, COVID duty is 6 hours as opposed to 8 hours because of the PPE. And I found really strange stories. People would say the smell of the plastic lingers on. If we go home for 2 days, no one's willing to, you know, touch us because that plastic smell carries on. My head hurts. I met a nurse who said that, you know, no one even thought of designing this thing for women because I got my period when I was in the PPE. The nurse was telling me that, you know, you have no idea what it feels like to be a woman bleeding in this damn thing, which is covered head to toe and is designed in a way that you can't even lift it and go to the loo. It's just one long, like, you know. So I realized that there's something about it that is not, you know, and I bring it up only because these, it's not so much about me, but there were people who were in this day after day after day after day. And they actually said it made them physically sick. It made them physically sick, but this was all that was available. And they didn't know whether what made them sick was that they couldn't breathe. These face shields that people would wear, they would fog up. People couldn't see. The number of doctors I have met who said, it just falls off. When you run into the ICU to intubate someone, it either smogs up, or it fogs up, or it falls off, and they still had to go ahead and do this. So for me, this PPE became like a way of understanding the sort of complexity of what we were dealing with, and that medicine had not quite given us the tools to counter it, even in protected environments.
Okay, let me just move into, with the context of not enough ground reporting having been done in the beginning on COVID, and the COVID-induced economic shock that is inevitable, and some people are already feeling it. The stock market definitely isn't, but there are more complicated reasons for that. Without going into the usual, you know, hai news ki maut ho gai kind of thing, surely the professionals are the same. You and I have seen many of the people work. I have seen many of them change. In fact, I was on a panel with Deepak Chaurasia some time ago. I was like, dude, we were at NewsTrack. Yeah. You were not this person.
Well, he was a fabulous reporter at one point. Yeah.
So what do you think has determined news abandoning reporting and embracing another model? Why do you think that is? Diagnose that for us.
So before I answer this, I have to have a mea culpa moment. And the mea culpa moment is that if I had not left television, and I left it for a variety of reasons, but we don't have to get into that, or we could later if you ask me about it, but for the moment, because that's not the question, if I had not left television, I suspect that while I would never have been a shouty TV anchor, hate-mongering, I may have become a lazy journalist. There was something about it that had become so formulaic. There was something about it that was just this stale thing of one right wing, one left wing, one centrist, put them together, do the news of the day, they'll debate amongst themselves, the audience will be somewhat bored, somewhat entertained, you'll go home. Although I always thought of myself as a kind of true-blooded reporter, and I would still have my breakout moments, but I was also falling into this trap of that becoming my everyday. Why does it happen? It happens, one, primarily because the revenue model, as you know, is totally broken. Nobody in television newsrooms has money, right? So you've got to negotiate all the time with your editors or your owners or your promoters. Give us the budget to go. And you know what those budget discussions are like. Why do you need this? Where will you stay? Achha, itna paisa, ye toh hamare paas hai nahi. So talk is cheap. Secondly, there is some sense that news has shifted into the background noise for those who still watch it on television. I don't know how many people do, but it seems to have shifted into this thing that happens in the back while you're busy doing something else. So I think television feels this great compulsion to somehow grab your attention, and they don't think that they can grab your attention with a nuanced, complex story that needs you to actually listen or watch. And therefore they think that if you make a lot of noise, or you have some character, or you have some flamboyance in that thing, then maybe people will look up from their chola bhatura and watch you, or from their mobile phone and watch you, because otherwise they're not watching you. The third thing is the what I call the ornibification of television news, or what, you know, the failure, let's say, of the Congress vis-a-vis the BJP. There are parallels in politics. And what I mean by that is, there was this formula, and, you know, whatever we may think of him, and, you know, I've never made any bones about what I think of him. There was a formula that an Arnab Goswami brought to television content. And what everybody else started doing was to be pale imitations of that. So you couldn't be that because you felt embarrassed, or you just couldn't shout like that, or you didn't want to be that. But you felt this pressure to be some version of that. And in that being some version of that, you weren't anything. You weren't anything. You were just doing some variant of the Arnab Goswami shouty talk show with many postage stamp sized windows, and you were ending up being nothing because you weren't being authentic to yourself, right? And so I think, and why I brought up the Congress BJP is because it's a little bit similar. Like, you know, first the Congress like attacked the BJP, and then it decided to become some version of it, right? And it was just bad at being a version of the BJP. So it ended up being nothing. So, I mean, I'm just trying to borrow from other spaces, and, you know, Pepsi Coke parallels have been drawn. There any number in corporate India, you'll find parallels like this, that you try and be somebody else, you're not fully them, and you're not then no longer yourself. So I think all of these things happened, and then I think with COVID, I don't know if there was a fourth factor of fear. I think some people were just, who have reported otherwise, which there's some really decent reporters who have still not stepped out of their house. Some of them are my friends. I have fought with them saying, what the hell is wrong with you? You just can't, I don't know what it is. It's like some collective paralysis.
Okay, now you, I mean, we have, I don't want to get into the details of it, but the Sushant Singh Rajput case, there are political reasons for it. But from being just, you know, unfortunate suicide of a star, it has become this huge conspiracy. I personally think there is not enough evidence to support that conspiracy. But if a CBI inquiry can get us that clarity, well and good. But it was a creation of media. That now, it's hard to say whether the, you know, rather hysterical news media caused that decision. But we have seen in the past that television has an impact that print doesn't. While print has a certain credibility, it doesn't have the impact that television does. That noise does sometimes make things happen. We have seen that in the case of Justice Vajeska. We've seen that in the case of the Jan Lokpal movement. We've seen that in several cases. Do you feel, as a news professional, impact trumps quality? That if you had a show at prime time, and Barkha Dutt's show, irrespective of what other formulae were happening, and I have my disagreements with you on many other issues, but it was a show of quality, and it would have an impact. Do you feel that while you can do quality journalism here, what is the impact? And do you still think television has the impact that you could make happen back then?
So it's a really interesting question, and I don't think there's an easy yes or no answer to it, if I had to be honest. Can you have an impact by being an independent, small, 8-person team? That's what I am. I have 8 people in my team, and I'm the primary journalist in it, right? As of now. The short answer is yes. COVID taught me that if your reporting is robust, you are able to kind of break through the crowd. You are. You have to just be committed, consistent, and passionate, the same things you were in television. Is it tougher? It's tougher primarily because you don't have access to the same sort of resources. So you don't have, you know, the necessary reach or the advertising muscle or the marketing muscle to make yourself
But your voice can have an impact. It but can make things happen.
I personally think that the migrant exodus story is almost single-handedly associated with me today. And I didn't have a television show. So that was proof to me that it can have an impact. But do I have to work harder at it to have an impact? Yes. That's point one. Point two, there are certain kinds of things that unleash a sense of, I want to say mob, but it has also been channelized for, some would argue, good things. It has delivered justice, and Justice for Jessica was a campaign I was associated with. When I look back at the Jan Lokpal bill, I wonder whether we were as complex as we should have been. Like, those are questions you have. But television has the capacity to therefore unleash a mass collective I want to say hysteria, because that's actually what it is. Mm-hmm. That you and I don't have. You don't have it at News Laundry. I don't have it at Mojo. We're too small. We're too individual. So we don't have that. The question is, do you want to have that? I've done one interview on the Sushant Singh story, and a lot of people thought I did the wrong thing, and I really wrestled with it.
Yeah, we'll discuss that.
Yeah, and you can come to that. But I've literally done one, and then I did it, and I was like, you know what? I don't want to do this story. And in my life, I don't think I've ever said that about a story. But I don't want to do it. And I don't want to do it.
And in the beginning, when you did it, it was because everybody was doing it and that was the story. It was like the journalist in you that, then why did you do that?
Because a lot, when the Sushant Singh Rajput story or the initial nepotism debate started unfolding, I was still like a boring, earnest, sincere reporter doing COVID. I returned home from COVID after 130 days. So this thing had already started and I was in my COVID bubble. I was like, kuch ho raha hoga, mujhe nahi malum. I don't remember the last time I watched television news program. So I was like oblivious. When I came back, you know, someone in my house was watching flipping channels, as happens. And I heard an anchor on one of the main channels say about Riya Chakravarti, who I don't know. I didn't even know she existed till a month ago. She left her boyfriend. She left her boyfriend. She's a gold digger. The anchor was saying it, not a guest. The anchor was saying it. And something in me as a woman said, oh my God, tomorrow if I leave my boyfriend, they'll do the show on me. Literally, it was a tipping point for me as a woman to see. I know nothing about this Riya Chakravarti. I have no idea. I make no comments on the merits of this case. I know nothing about it. I don't know if this case is going to be registered as a homicide. I don't know if she's taken his money. I don't know anything about her. But to hear some loteri dulhan, that was the hashtag on Instagram. To have a woman deconstructed for making a personal choice in leaving a man, it really bothered me. And by coincidence, I get this phone call from a friend in Bombay, acquaintance, who said that Sushant Singh Rajput, and I know you want to ask me about this, so I'll just segue in briefly and then you can ask me what you want to, that Sushant Singh Rajput's therapist lives in my building. She wants to say something and nobody is willing to carry her statement. And I said, if your statement is official, I know Barkha will carry it. But you've not been covering the story. Why? She asked me the same question and I kind of gave her the same answer. And then she said, will you talk to her once? And then I spoke to her and I eventually carried a statement, but I know you want to ask me something about that. So go ahead.
So I'm just the context in case you haven't watched it. Enough reporting and panel discussions on this. The one that Barkha got a lot of heat on was she spoke to the therapist of Sushant Singh Rajput and asked him about his mental...
Her.
Asked her about his, mental makeup, and the therapist spoke about it, and you got a lot of flack saying that this breaches, patient-doctor privilege, and as a reporter, you shouldn't have done that. Mm-hmm. And I did read up, someone had said that the law, even doctors are also bound by the law. They cannot breach their privileges like lawyers are. Yeah. The exception is that in case it is to protect somebody else. For example, if, you know, Barkha is my therapist and I tell her I'm going to kill one of you, she's free to tell you that that's the only time it's breached. But here, that wasn't the case. So, do you think it was inappropriate? Were you aware of the law? Do you regret it now? Where are you on that?
So, I wish I hadn't got into the story because I just find the story odious. It's the only story in 22 years of being a journalist that I don't want to touch. But I don't believe I was wrong to give space to that therapist, and I'll tell you why. I don't believe I was wrong. I'm thinking about that, but yeah, I don't believe I was wrong. And here's why I think not. I was not fully comfortable with it. That's why I'm still hesitating and I'm almost thinking my way through. So if I was fully comfortable, I would have said that immediately. But on reflection even, I think it was necessary. And I think it was necessary because, and here's what actually happened. So this woman turned out to be a British woman who lives in Bombay. Again, I know nothing about her. I've never met her. I know nothing about her. The one thing maybe I could have done was a little more homework on her. If you ask me what I could have done differently, I could have done a little more homework on her. But after 2-3 conversations, the initial agreement was for an interview. She finally called me. She said, Barkha, I'm British. They won't let me survive here if I do an interview with you. But I have a statement. This is the statement I gave to the police. And I would like it released on a media platform. I sent it to so-and-so group, so-and-so group, so-and-so group. Nobody's willing to publish it because it doesn't go with the dominant narrative of our time. Can I send you the statement? So she sent me the statement. The statement basically said that he had a bipolar disorder and that she did not recognize the Riya Chakrabarti that she saw described on television, because it was Riya who had always got him to all their sessions and she had tried her best to look after Sushant the best that she could. Now, at that time, I think the news person in me took over and I said to her, this is a very, no one's going to read text. She said, what do you want me to do? I'm not going to do an interview. So I said, well, it has to be your, this is your take. So why don't you say it in your voice? And she said, but no questions. I said, but I have some questions offline that I need to understand. And she said, what? And I said, the first thing I'm going to be asked is that you are breaking privilege with your patient. Mm-hmm. And how are you okay doing that? And she said, I'm okay doing that because I worry that another life should not be lost. And I have seen this vilification of this girl and I'm not comfortable with it. So I believe this is a thing for me to do. So I told her, I said, I know nothing about this girl and I still stand by this. I have no idea whether this is right, wrong, whatever. But it doesn't seem right to me that you can't get your statement out. Now, on reflection, it was pointed out to me that ideally her statement should have gone to the cops and I should have journalistically been able to source it from the cops. And I think that would have been maybe a better way to do it, but the moral question would still have remained.
Yeah. Right? You would be... It would be legally more appropriate, but the ethics moral of it question. Would be the same, whether you do it this way or that way, sure.
But I am saying that if the narrative has become that this person is not depressed and the ferocious resistance to even contemplating that he could have had a mental health disorder, and this is playing out in public. So a lot of doctors I spoke to suggested that she could have said this to the police and the police should have quietly investigated this dimension. And I said, for me, this is not a police dimension. I find it really problematic as somebody who has reported on mental health issues that there is such a ferocious resistance that people are saying dumb things like, but he looked happy. See this photograph. He was smiling in this photo. See, he's smiling. Well, he can't have mental
health. It's happening even now, even after, you know, we published a piece on Dummies Guide to Mental Health for News Anchors, but it clearly has no impact. Okay, let me move on to...
So then, was it the best decision? No. Do I really regret it? No. Because I think when something starts playing out in public, the counter also has to be in public.
Sure. Okay. Now, let's come to your journey to Mojo. I have seen you, and I say this purely as far as reach is concerned, not the quality of reporting. Your prime is still to come. But I've seen you to your prime when Barkha Dutt was the most well-known journalist in the country. I have seen the kind of impact you had, the kind of influence you had. Why did you not stick with broadcast? Surely your shows had not become what we see now, and they need not have if you didn't want that to. From NDTV to Tiranga to Mojo, tell us about that journey. Why did you leave each of these places?
Okay. So NDTV, I feel like, if I feel like I made a mistake, it is that I didn't leave earlier. And what I mean by that is that it was a very protected place. It was a brilliant place for young people. It was a very, very super place to learn your skills and to maybe be in your 20s, in your 30s. But I kind of was still there in my early 40s. I'm 48 now. And, you know, I left it in 2017. And I think what ended up happening was that I saw a lot of my peers having left and gone on to what I thought were more independent things, independent of the strangle. It was like leaving home, you know, how you sort of, you're like...
Your peers like Rajdeep, etc.
Even in Arnab. Even in Arnab had left.
But that didn't quite work out.
Not initially. But I'm just saying that I think what happened was that sometimes you outgrow that sense of... This is how my bosses think journalism has to be done and I'm going to listen to them because I'm an employee. I think that, to be completely fair to them, I evolved into my own person. And we did not always have the same sense of what content should look like, what news should be like. When I was younger, I was much more willing and able to go by Pranoy and Radhika's sense of what news should look like. But as I grew older, I had very definitive opinions of my own and we often had arguments. And those arguments... mostly were absorbed till we had till we started having some terrible arguments over one or two stories. And eventually, until this date, I don't know, a couple of my stories were censored. Like, I did them and I was simply told, you've got to drop them. You've just got to drop these stories. They've got to go off. And look, looking back and given the state of the media, I don't think this should have been headline news to me. But I was much more impetuous then. I was less calm then. And I kept saying, but why? And there was no good answer. And I said, is it pressure from the government? Because by then we all knew that there were multiple cases by the government against them. Now, whether it was pressure or not, they didn't want to concede that to me. I still think that's what happened. I still think that that's what caused them to drop the stories that they did with me. And by the end of it, we just argued so much that they felt that if they were to keep me in this kind of daily news role, we would argue all the time. And I felt like I was absolutely right. And I wanted to be in daily news, but I just didn't want to be in daily news here anymore because we were arguing too much. And so when my contract ended, we kind of both said, we can't see eye to eye with each other anymore. It's time to go.
So after what, 20, 22 years stint there?
Well, I joined in 95, so 95, and I left in 2017.
22 years stint there. Would you say that your parting was amicable? Or because sometimes one still sees a lot of anger from you on social media against them.
I mean,
them.
Not for a while now.
So yeah,
I
but think, initially
I
one
think,
day.
I think I'm kind of over it now. But I was extremely resentful and angry and cynical in the way that we parted.
Why?
Because I felt that they had not lived up to the image of editorial integrity that they had conveyed to me all my life and that they conveyed to the outside world. And I felt that they were not straightforward enough with me. Like, I'm able to say, look, we outgrew each other. It happens between people. We argued about stories. The environment had become untenable. And I see it as a mutual process. I don't know that they would acknowledge it as such. I think their personalities are different. I think they're less plain spoken. They're less blunt. And they'd be like, no, Barkha just wanted to move on. And, you know, we wish her all the best. That's not what happened. I mean, what happened was we had a fight over censorship, over the censorship of a story. And the argument got unpleasant and we both felt that we don't get along anymore. That's what happened, right? So it was not an amicable parting and it remained fraught for a while. And then, you know, you get over these things. And I got over it.
And then came Tiranga. Now,
which was a terrible mistake.
Okay, tell us about that. Why did you take that up? For those of you who know, Tiranga was a channel floated by Kapil Sibal, among others. I'm guessing it wasn't just his baby. And that didn't last very long. It just was launched just before the general election. Why did you take that up?
So since we're speaking so plainly, when I left NDTV, the initial response of people was I had a flood of offers from literally every channel, maybe short of Republic and Times Now. You know, almost all of the other channels were like, why don't you come and do a show with us? By then, I did feel like having left this Chhatra Chaya of NDTV, it would be nice to be a consultant somewhere and try and grow a company of my own. So maybe do some shows, but not become a full-time employee. And the UP 2007, so I said, and the other thing I did was I said, I want to learn the digital medium. So I wrote to Raghav Behel, who runs Quint, and I said, can I come and work with you for a month? I don't want anything. I just want to learn this medium. So he said, will you cover the elections for us? I said, sure. So I told everybody, I'm not going to go from NDTV straight to another channel. I want to just step back, take a few months off. It's the first time I'm taking some time off in 22 years. So I went and I did this 1 month gig just to learn what a digital newsroom is like. And I'd had all of these other conversations with these channels and the offers were very specific. They were down to terms, staff, whatever. And when the BJP swept the UP election, each one of these offers was withdrawn. And I was basically told that, you know, given the political environment, we cannot give you a show, right? So I didn't automatically think that I never wanted to be on TV. Basically, the doors of television were shut to me. And initially, that made me extremely cynical because whether or not, you know, I aspire to be the best, but even if I'm not the best, I'd certainly count myself among the top five broadcast journalists of this country. And to me, to say, to hear from people that as among the top five broadcast journalists of this country, we don't want you on television because the politics doesn't allow it. And some extremely rich, powerful promoters said this to me to my face, right? And so I understood that I'm not going to get a television show. I'm not going to get it. And I can either sit on my haunches and feel sorry for myself, or I've just got to get up, get on with life, and find I still know this medium, and I've got to know how to speak its grammar somewhat differently for the digital age.
Tiranga was basically...
And in the middle of all this, I get this call saying, listen, we want to have a channel, and we promise you it will not be a Congress channel. There are other people. There's Karan Thapar. So all of these credible names had been sort of tied up. We're looking for a professional editor. They got Manish Chhibber, who was an old-time legal course, to be the editor. And I was just like, listen, I can't be the editor of this channel because I knew that would create a set of conflicts. But I'm happy to do a show for you as a consultant. And that was signed on. And then, unfortunately, I think all of us who said yes to the channel were very stupid. But I think we were in the same position. Karan had been shown the door. For also political reasons. And since then we've seen this trend. You will see an increasing number of people who were on television who are now not on television. And I suspect that the reason is political in every single case. Political meaning, I don't think the government has called these people. Mm-hmm. Let's be fair to the government. I don't think that Mr. Amit Shah has called someone and said, Barkha ko shoban dena. I think someone has decided, yaar, why take this chance?
Yes, hamare yahan kahawat hai, samajhdar ke liye ishara
kaafi. Okay. Ishara hai bhi nahi to Tiranga was a mistake.
Okay. So you said it was, now, do you also think that, and then it was announced, but you and Shekhar are supposed to launch print together, that did happen. What I'm getting at is, and rather bluntly, has Barkha become too big? Barkha is the brand. She can't build a team. Like, the frequency with which the falling out happens with promoters, your fight with Kapil Sibal and his wife on social media, it was pretty intense. Your take on
you've never fought with a promoter.
No, I have, but I have been a promoter.
You're just not Barkha, so no one's discussing your life in public. That's the only difference.
The thing, I started small screen when I was 24. And when I was 24, I couldn't fight Arun Puri or Madhu Thiruvengadam or anything. But the point is that, do you think the skill set required to set up a team and an enterprise is very different from being a good reporter?
Yes, yes, yes. I have no problem acknowledging that my primary exposure has been to be the maverick of the newsroom, who's brilliant at her work, but probably has the reputation of not being an organization person in terms of not having those skills of patience, indulgence, whatever it is.
Decision making is different as a promoter, it's different as a reporter. And when you wear both hats,
yes,
it will not work out, is what I'm trying to get at.
No, so there are two separate things here. You said to me, do you think the skill sets needed are different?
And has Barkha become too big a star?
So let me answer step by step. Are the skill sets needed to be a great reporter and a good entrepreneur different? The short answer is yes. Did I always have the skills needed to be an entrepreneur? The short answer is no. I spent most of my life as a journalist, right, as an employee in an organization where I did not have to think about anything but the story. Do the fights with the promoters show that I am not a good team leader? The short answer is no. To me, the fight with the promoters shows that I'm a person of integrity who has the guts to call a spade a spade. Maybe that doesn't make me very clever. Maybe that doesn't make me very diplomatic. Maybe that makes it difficult for me to survive in the environment we're in this country. But in both of the cases that I had the fight, and that doesn't mean that I'm blameless at all times, but I'm just saying these particular fights that I had a fight with one over the censorship of a story. I had a fight with the other because he put 150 to 200 people who were earning 20,000 rupees on the street and refused to pay them even a month's salary. And I had to publicly confront him because he was refusing to pay these people. And although I was not their editor, I was not their entrepreneur, I was not their team leader, I felt a moral pressure to speak up for them because I think a lot of them came to the channel because they said, Barkha waha hai aur Karan Thapar waha hai, to theek hi hoga. The result of that is that Kapil Sibal refused to pay me my year's salary because he was so pissed off with me that I had spoken for these people. So they got paid and I didn't get paid and I'm in court against him. Now, a number of well-meaning people said exactly this, ki tumhara reputation ye ho jayega, tum sabke saath ladai karte ho, mat karo ye case file. And I said, no, this man has done this because he thinks he's a big lawyer and I'll be too scared to take him to court. I'm not scared. What is left to happen? The television industry has told me that you're very good. Each one of them said you're very good. but boss politics. Right? Now, am I going to let this define my self-esteem in my life? So I have many flaws. I have a, you know, I have a volatile side to my personality. I react, I'm tempestuous, I'm impetuous. But in both the cases you've cited, I did the correct thing, in my opinion.
Are you a prima donna?
What's wrong with being a prima donna?
I'm not saying anything wrong.
Do men get asked this question?
Sorry?
Do men get asked this question?
I would. I mean,
isn't prima
like,
donna
example,
a gendered adjective?
Maybe it is gendered, but I will not get defensive on being accused of sexism
I'm
here.
No, I will say. But women are seen.
Sure, but that's not true. I mean, right? I will say, for example, you know, I have for a year and a half worked in Bollywood as an assistant director. There were many male stars who we used to call prima donnas. Ki wo 2 ghante late aayenge, shots jab tak tayar nahi hoga. Am I saying has Barkha become bigger than the brand, so no brand wants her?
No. I was told in each case, I was given very specific offers to do shows. So I was clearly not a prima donna when I was given those offers, right? I was given offers down to this is what we'll pay you. This is the number of people you'll work with. This is the time slot that you'll be doing your show in. And those offers were taken back after a certain political development. So clearly, whether or not I'm a prima donna, that risk was considered worth taking, point one. Point two, am I a prima donna in that I will eat anything, I will sleep anywhere, I will work 24 hours a day. What I do not do is I do not mince my words. Does that get me into trouble? Yes. Does that make me the easiest employee to have? No. Every promoter would want someone who doesn't argue back. Do I argue back? Yes. Does this make me always wrong? No, I think sometimes it makes the promoter wrong.
Fair enough. Yeah, so let's have some Q&A, although I still have so many questions. But anyway, take it. But no, let's get the audience in. So one by one, if you could just raise your hands, I'll call out to you and then you can ask your question. Do we have any questions? Otherwise, I'll just continue with mine. Okay, I have one with the lady there at the back and one with the gentleman. So let's start with the lady there and then the gentleman in the white suit.
Hello.
Hi.
So I've been following your Instagram very incessantly. So I just have a general question.
Yeah.
You've met and worked with all types of people, right? And you've been in contact with people in power, and I don't mean just politically.
Yeah.
So these are people who influence the common man and woman of this country every day. So why do you think a lot of these people don't speak up or reach out about a lot of issues?
Because then you're asked if you're a prima donna. No, but more seriously. Because there is an environment of complete Chinese whispers, right? I actually think, so there are two parts to it. A lot of people don't speak because somebody has told them you'll get into trouble if you speak. Who that somebody is, if you dig a little deeper, wo mujhe usne bola tha, usko kisne bola, usko usne bola tha, usko kisne bola, usko, which doesn't mean that we are not in a more controlled political environment than before. We are. There are no two ways about that. When you have a party in government that has enormous electoral muscle, there is a sense that people are more wary of speaking out against it, right? The other thing that's happened is the sense of the mob. I have seen any number of people on social media, in particular on social media, who are not able to express what they really believe because they get trolled. Mm. And, you know, some of us are so thick-skinned, we're like, I'm telling you, it's like a vaccine for me, right? If you want to talk about the language, I don't care. Sometimes I react, even I react. But I have seen younger people, thinner skinned people who are like, yeah, hum kuch nahi bolenge.
Not just younger people, even older people, it impacts them deeply.
So the toxicity of social media combined with the fear of power has made a lot of people keep quiet. And combined with, you know, sometimes it takes one person to break the chain. One person speaks, other people are ready to speak. And I think we saw that in some ways in the protests against the NRC, which with all its muscle, the government did not go through with it because there were young kids protesting. And it's very difficult for a government to fight with 18-year-olds.
The young man there in the white suit, yeah. And everyone, if you just keep your questions short so we can get more in.
Sure. Hey, Barkha, I'm Sumit. Thank you for the evening, Abhinandan and Barkha. So first, Barkha, I am privileged to, encounter someone at that stage of the life where someone says that this is the moment that I have lived for. I mean, thank you for saying that, the Kargil story and something that you would relate to that. So my question essentially is, where is the journalism headed? Because I would, in my individual capacity, I would respect probably the gentleman on the Republic TV for certain reasons, but for you, for certain different reasons. But I'm confused now. Where are we headed? He covers one story. You say that this is not a story at all.
No,
this,
I didn't
just
say
an
that.
Example.
No. I want to say something. I don't think Sushant Singh Rajput is not a story. I think it's a story. I just don't think it's a story that is bigger than the Chinese still sitting in Galwan, the fact that our infection rate is spiking, but our death rate is quite low on COVID, on the fact that 1.8 crore salaried people have lost their jobs since April. It's a story, but is it the only story? That's all I'm saying. My personal reason for not getting into it is that I'm not able to really... Today, India Today has published the WhatsApp conversation between a film director and Riya Chakrabarty. I can't do this. I can't sit here and speculate over what happened at some party, who slept with whom, who said, who had an affair with whom, then I should have joined Filmfare, yaar. I just, this is not my skill set. So you have to recognize, that's why if I made a mistake with a therapist interview, to just venture into the story at all. I think that was a bigger mistake. I had stayed out of it, I should have stayed out of it. Because this is... It's not in my skill set. I don't know how to do this story. I'm no good at it.
And also, we have a question there, but I will just want to step in on this. Okay, we have three here. That Barkha is a lot more polite, although she is blunt at times. This time she hasn't been. The gentleman you mentioned, Arnab, I don't believe what he's doing is journalism or it's a story. In fact, on News Laundry, we've done a report of the so-called activist who he had there, whose conspiracy theory... This entire thing has been spun around, and we spoke, I mean, not I, but my colleague, the reporter, spoke to that guy. He says, "Maine to aise likh diya tha, maine kisi se baat ki thi." So when I was a young reporter at NewsTrack, and I've said this on a podcast, you know, we used to keep hearing there was a N.K. Singh, was I think Revenue Secretary, and there was raids on Madhuri Dixit and Shah Rukh Khan. There were a bunch of raids, and many, we used to get theories, ki bhai, kyun raid hui Madhuri Dixit ghar pe? We did not go on television and say, by the way, is this true or is it not? If you don't have evidence, someone has just payloaded something. So payloading something every night is not journalism. So I'm not saying you shouldn't respect him, but maybe you should respect him for being a good circus master. I think it is vile what he does. And I, at least, I'm not going to let that pass with politeness. Sorry, the gentleman there. Okay, there's a young boy here. After that, we'll come there and then the lady here.
Hi, Barkha. Thanks so much for taking your time
today.
Where are you?
Sorry. Yo. Oh, yeah, there. Hi.
Yeah, hi. So I had a question which was sort of related to something I've been tackling. Like, we've started to relate news channels to political organizations.
Yeah.
So as an insider, I wanted to understand, you know, what is this politics and news nexus sort of run like? Can you shed some light on that?
So all my life, a certain section has called me a Congressee. I want to tell this audience that the Gandhis don't speak to me and hate me. Right? To which Abhinandan is going to say it must be
get in line.
Madonna.
Get in line.
Yeah, okay. But this is, I'm sharing this for a reason. We have got into this very dangerous space as an audience, and I now want to throw this back at you guys. You go to content looking, it's a confirmation bias problem. If I do not confirm your bias or what you want to hear, you're going to call me the other side. You guys have no idea what truly independent people go through. We make enemies every day, right? People dislike us for a story every day. The more mature politicians sometimes sulk for a year, 2 years, then they make up. The less mature politicians just don't talk to you at all, and they decide they don't need to because there's now so much media that if they don't talk to you, they'll talk to someone else, right? So I think that while to some extent, our media is mirroring our politics in terms of the polarization. And it's what I call, and I really am going to patent this phrase, I feel that our media has become chamcha ya morcha, that there are only two kinds of media now. So there's either the full chaplusi ki pair pe, you know, let jao. Or there's the other, which is like full, like, sadak pe nikle morcha bazi. Personally, I have a problem with both models. Just because at heart I'm a reporter and I think let the story speak. If the story is factually true, it'll, you know, let it have its own impact. But you don't need to be an activist to make your point. You should be a journalist. Your story should make the point, not you. That is my belief. So this nexus, I think it's overstated. I think what's actually happening in journalism today is that 80% of media is beholden to power. Power, simply. It's a very powerful government. They think the audience, the people who vote for them also want to hear the same thing. They're doing it because they think all of you want it. And 20% is so ideological, or maybe 18%, because there are some 2% of us floaters. But there is an 18% that is like, this is so evil. All our journalism is going to be somehow to prove that they're awful. So if you talk to anyone right of center, you're a traitor. Right? I am a classic example of someone not left enough for the left and not right enough for the right. I mean, I don't fit into these camps at all. I just do what I think is correct.
The gentleman in the corner there, if you can get that, and this young lady. Okay, fine. Let's go with her first. Yeah. And after that, we can just take the mic there. Yeah.
Okay, sure. Oh, sorry. Hi. So just, I think, going off of that question, I kind of had the same question, but how do you stay afloat if you're an independent, like, media house and you're not a barkha? That, like, because obviously...
It's not that it's easy for me to stay afloat.
No, but I mean, I would say that...
You mean as a business or as monetarily,
as
right?
Business.
Yeah, yeah, I know.
And also, like, just a little bit of a follow-up as well, that, like, where would you see the money come from if not, like, people who expect to impose their narrative on you?
Yeah. So I think that's a great question. And I think... I'm sure Abhinandan will add to this because I think a lot of India. So just see, pause for a moment and think of the number of people, because all of you, I'm sure, serve content online, who are now doing their own ventures. Small, big, medium, right? There's something happening. There's a churn happening. The churn may have started for political or coercive reasons. But I think to be fair to all of the individuals in this space, we've embraced it and we've made it our own moment and we are doing the damnedest best we can with the opportunities that we have. And we're remaining authentic to our voice. Good, bad, ugly, we are remaining who we are. We expect, bluntly, the money to come from all of you. And let me explain what I mean by that. You've got to start paying for content. You cannot non-stop complain. Everywhere I go, people complain non-stop about TV media in particular. That's the one thing that people complain about. They don't necessarily complain about newspapers. They complain non-stop about TV media. But you are willing to pay that whatever, I don't know what it costs now, 500 rupees to Tata Sky? What does a Tata Sky subscription cost?
Depends on your package, madam.
Okay. Mujhe toh, maine toh all hi nahi kiya.
EX News chahiye, batai kya chahiye.
But you're willing to pay whatever X to Tata Sky, right? To get that package. If you really like the content of, it can be whoever. It doesn't have to be me. It doesn't have to be Abhinandan. If there's someone you see whose content that you like, that person is eventually going to turn to subscription. Eventually, that is the future of content. And secondly, I know News Laundry, you're advertisement free, right?
Yes.
So I am not that puritanical about this. I believe that advertising will have to move from television to digital. Already on YouTube, and both of us are on YouTube, algorithmically ads are placed.
We've disabled it.
You've disabled them. So I accept the algorithm. My channel is monetized on YouTube. I accept the algorithmic ads. So unlike Abhinandan, who is statedly free from advertising, I don't think that that's realistic for the stage of media that we're at. So I believe that advertisers should understand that they are backing stale, formulaic things, and they should have at least some significant percentage of their advertising moving to digital content. So I see the future of digital content coming from two or three places. One is subscription or contributions from viewers who believe in your product. The second is advertising moving. And the third is that non-news is going to have to subsidize news. And there's just no getting around this. And the best publications in the world, you know, there's a New Yorker festival that happens every summer. People do, pre-COVID, all of us did offline events as a way to generate revenue, and we channeled or funneled that revenue back into our companies. I believe a combination of these three will remain how we'll survive.
I'll just quickly, you know, News Laundry was started in 2012, and I had very clearly at that time stated, me and my co-founder Madhu Trehan, that we will be ad-free because our slogan is, when the public pays, the public is served. I had actually saved this moment for the end of the interview, but I shall do it right now. We believe that And that's a positioning thing. Why we've disabled Google Ads and YouTube pre-roll ads is because you can't position yourself as an ad-free platform. When the public pays, the public is served. When advertisers pay, advertisers are served. That is the slogan we go with. Pay to keep news free. So I urge all of you, go to newslaundry.com, pay to keep news free, because you can't expect advertisers to pay and then news to serve you. They will serve the advertiser. That is just too basic a relationship. And I think it is inevitable for news to survive, for journalism to survive. It will become subscription-driven. When I started in 2012, I was told by everyone that there is no way this is happening. I can tell you, I can sustain myself on subscriptions. I don't need an advertiser.
And do you have a fixed rate?
We have to. You have to have a fixed rate, and your chartered accountant will explain it to you that if you keep it open, then the government will say service tax, though, sub pay, though, I mean, they'll screw you. You have to. I mean, you have to be very careful about what you do, especially the news is a very high risk and low returns business. People who are in news, and people who are purely in news, are in news because they're passionate about it. If you own mining and you're in news, you're doing it as a lobbying for your mining. But people who are only doing news, it's very high risk and low returns. But I believe that eventually everybody will start become subscribe based. Many people who would tell me back in 2012, 2013. तुम खाली पुलाव बना रहे हो कोई इंडियंस नहीं देंगे पैसे मेरे इंडियंस देते हैं पैसे और वो हमें देते हैं पैसे और अगर आप अगस्त में न्यूज़ लॉन्ड्री की सब्सक्रिप्शन लो ये मैं मत बरखा के लिए लाया हूँ गिफ्ट यू गेट इंडिपेंडेंस डे मंथ जैस्मिन लेमन ग्रास एंड ऑरेंज सोप डूइंग सबकी धुलाई बिकॉज वी डू सबकी धुलाई हिंदू मुस्लिम सिख ईसाई सबकी धुलाई सबकी धुलाई Barkha, please, this is Sabki Dhulai soap set, which comes with a subscription of News Laundry, which Barkha can have for at least 20 seconds. It will kill all Kitanu and all that. It's the Sabki Dhulai soap set. So, if you don't pay for news, don't complain to me about it. Suck it up and watch Arnab. Yeah, there.
Yeah, hi. Barkha, yes. My question was that I'm sure you've had a journey when you were a young journalist. And a purist. I'm sure along the journey, once you have experience, it builds perceptions, mm-hmm. it builds biases.
Sure.
And as you grow in influence, and I'm sure when you report a story now, do you think, how are you able to keep your personal bias or your ability to voice a certain side of the story away from the true side of the story? There might be some internal conflict within you that you are seeing one side of it because you're leaning towards one side of it and projecting that.
Yeah.
And how do you keep that thing going that it remains pure?
So there are two, three different things here, right? Are any of us clinically objective? It's not possible. We are trained to see the world in a certain way. We are triggered by different things. Certain things that I find offensive, somebody else may not find offensive. Certain things that anger me may not anger somebody else. On certain stories where I can see that there's another side, the best I can do is to give equal space to both sides. But if it's a story where I believe that there is no other side, like I don't believe in my assessment, in my best assessment, there is only a singular truth, I don't think that it's my job to give the other side, right? There are personal conflicts. I do not do stories on friends. I don't do them. I don't do good stories on friends and I don't do critical stories on friends because I do not trust myself to be objective. I think the best way to handle that is maybe to disclose a relationship if it exists or whatever, or to step aside from that story. I don't believe that it's possible really for me now, tomorrow, if you were like one of my oldest childhood friends and you were in some story, I'd rather just sit out the story and let everybody wonder why I'm sitting out that story, but I know that it's a conflict of interest for me. So there are three buckets of what you've said. Where there's a personal angle involved, I would ideally not like to do that story. And I have lost certain friendships because I have done the story because that issue has been big enough for me to do the story and lose the friendship. But I don't trust myself to be, I mean, I'm not a robot. There are people who are my friends who I don't trust myself to report on objectively, and I try and sit out those stories. If you're talking about my ideology, I think the best I can do is to give people who are different from my ideology the same space, But there will be the odd story where I will think that there is no other side. I'm trying to give you an example, but I mean, I can give you examples of sexual violence where I don't think there's another side. I just don't think there's another side. So I don't know that I would think that there's any objectivity left to convey in that story, for example. So that's how I handle it. There's no perfect formula.
So we'll move on to any other questions. There's one here, but I'll just quickly, Aristotle said that you must always plug your product wherever you are. He didn't. It's just one of those. There's a podcast I've done on objectivity on News Laundry. It's a paid for podcast. You have to subscribe to listen to it. Where the myth of objectivity or not being biased, only math is not objective. Even physics and chemistry is subjective. So the best you can do is stick to the facts as you know it. Yeah. But the prism of our life experiences will, come through, and that is inevitable. So when I hear the word objectivity thrown around, and you know, like Barkha said, we have used to seeing films like Mother India, where Nargis shoots Sunil Dutt, and Nirupa Roy gives the gun to Shashi Kapoor. You know, Bhagwan kare, sawal poochte vakt tera mic na kaampe. She says, goli chalate vakt tere haath na kaampe. But that doesn't really happen in real life.
So one very fundamental question. We started this evening with migrants and the entire migrant crisis. Question to you is that will the migrants stay back? Will they return? And what will influence their decision one way or the other?
So this is a story I actually did follow to its logical conclusion, because one of the things journalists are accused of is that you do the headline, then you never follow through. So towards the end of my journey, I actually went to multiple villages where migrants had returned to see what was happening after they'd returned. And it was really tragic, because we found that the penury and the poverty that they'd sought to escape in the city, they'd faced exactly the same penury and the poverty in the village. And so there's this complete sense of panic, and most of them said, yahan to kuch nahi hai, hame wapas jana padega. Par wapas jayenge, pata nahi factory khula hai, nahi khula. So I think you're going to see the beginning of reverse migration. In the sense of them returning to the cities. But I don't think there are enough jobs in the cities. So I think this is going to be the next big crisis. And the second big crisis, and I'm 100% sure of this because I've documented it, almost every migrant worker is in debt. Everybody either took debt to travel to the village or is now taking debt to come back to the city or to feed their children. And remember that, there's a whole children dimension. They're coming back to the city, but without their families. So I do think that the second phase, I mean, we haven't spoken about COVID at all. I do think that we've got over the worst in COVID, and I wish we could spend 5 minutes just speaking about that separately. But the humanitarian and the economic crisis is only just beginning.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. Hello, ma'am. Thank you so much for being here. My question is, this year, India got ranked 142 in Global Press Freedom Index, right? What can we do to stop this erosion of freedom? And by when I say we, I mean not only the journalists, but also we as consumers of journalism. How can we work towards stopping that erosion of freedom?
Well, for one, I think we have to stop being the urban Indian who says, why can't we be more like China? I mean, I guess after COVID, at least we'll stop saying that, right? But the number of people who actually feel that press freedom is not a big deal is actually a slightly scary thing, and many of them are my friends and family. So I'm not really making some big judgment here, but I know any number of people who say, yaar, I should have just stayed on in Singapore. Kya farak padta hai, ek akhbar nahi milta na? Kya farak padta hai? Because people now have that sense that news is not free here. And to be honest, most of mainstream media is captured today by power, by power, or by people's own biases, or by people's own need to suck up, right? So what can you do? You can support journalism that you believe in. It can be the Mojo story. It can be News Laundry. It can be Faye D'Souza. It can be Anubha Bhosle. It can be, I don't know, who else am I missing?
There's Scroll, there's Print, there's Swaraj, there's everybody's.
There's so many people who have broken free from sort of big corporate ownerships, right? And who are bit by bit, little by little, trying to create islands of excellence in the best way that they know how. I also think, and we didn't talk about this, that the future is not going to belong to big media, because I think the revenue model is so broken that they're not going to, very few of them will be able to survive. But small independent media will not survive either unless you pay for it, right? So Guardian has a model that I would personally, if the law permitted, like to embrace, which is that I would personally not want to say you've got to pay 250 rupees to watch my stories. I would like to say, if you can pay 50 rupees, pay 50 rupees. If you can pay 50,000 rupees, pay 50,000 rupees. If you can pay zero, you can still watch them, right? That's the Guardian model. And I would personally like to go with that model, but people have to care more about what they're being shown. Right now, the danger is people see TV news, at least, as entertainment. It's just to be laughed at, gossiped about.
But it does impact how they think.
But it does impact. I mean, the number of people who will today believe that Riya Chakravarti murdered Sushant Singh Rajput is only a function of what they've seen on television. Sure. And they might think it's funny, but it's actually not funny. You know, it's not funny. I'm saying I don't know what she did. But that some of us just believed it because it was said on TV enough times is scary.
So on that note, we shall call it a night.
Yeah,
Vivek.
I mean, I would have loved to get those 2-3 minutes on COVID.
Can I just want to share what on COVID?
Yes, please. I was going to ask you for that.
Because I really feel passionately about
this
COVID.
Please
it's
do.
A purely technical thing, but because I've devoted the last 5 months of my life on this, I think that you all may have read about what's called a serological survey. So if you haven't, let me tell you what's been happening. What's been happening is that sample surveys are being done in different cities to see if you have antibodies. The antibodies tell us very simply, I'm not using medical jargon here, whether you've had COVID and you may not even know it. Now in Bombay, the survey showed you that 57% of slums and 16% of non-slums have had COVID. Right? In Pune, the figure was about 27% or 29%. In Delhi, the figure was about 30%. And today, there's a survey out that says it's 26% pan-India. These numbers are actually even much higher because the sampling was not done in Bombay, for example, in the worst areas. Meaning Dharavi, for example, it was the worst area. That's not where the survey was taken. What does this tell us? It tells us that the infection is about 20 to 30 times possibly more widespread than the official data tells us. Now all of you are going to go, oh my God, this is terrible, oh God. No, it's good news because we have been computing our death rate by the known number of infections, right? So let's say we think 100 people have COVID and 2 people are dying every day. But it turns out that not 100 but 1,000 people have COVID, and even accounting for an underreporting of deaths which is taking place, 6 people are dying, not 2, 6 people. The infection fatality rate is still very low. So I'm not saying the people who are dying should be dying. I'm not saying you should go somewhere without your mask. You shouldn't sanitize. You shouldn't wash your hands. But I think that in localized areas, we are beginning to see clear evidence of herd immunity, which basically means enough of the population has the virus for it to have lost or diminished in its power to kill. Right? So things are getting better. I wish the government would come out and say, live your life. Wear your mask. If you go to Southeast Asian countries, you see people, it's a normal thing for people to wear their mask. If you're in crowded areas, wear your mask. Do not wear your mask if you go for a jog. Do not wear your mask if you go for a walk. Please do not. We've had people dying from this. Look, I'm no doctor, but this is really something I've spent my life obsessing about in the last 6 months. Things are way better and we need to step out of our fear and anxiety and start living again.
Yeah, and then on that note,
yes.
On that note, Haryana just announced a lockdown over the weekend. So there you go.
Okay,
so
weekend lockdown. That's
so thank you, Barkha. I must tell everybody, since News Laundry started, the whole idea was that we will do sabki dhulai, meaning journalists. And while politicians have very thin skins, they don't actually, it's the journalists who have the thinnest skins. And Barkha is one of the few who I can ask whatever I want. And I do not become katti. And there are many senior journalists who, if you have a disagreement with, they will never even talk to you again. So thank you, Barkha, for your candor. Thank you for your work, which has been amazing. And to all of you, support Mojo. I don't know if they have a payment gateway, but...
We do.
Okay, so...
We have such a poor
salesperson. So you got to... And if you subscribe to News Laundry during the month of August... you get the Sabki Dhulai soap set. Is that cool or what? So, on that note, have a great evening. Thank you for being a wonderful audience. Thank you, Vivek, for this wonderful experience after a long time. I hope we can do this more often. Thank you.